Thank you for joining us tonight for this Good Friday service. We gather in memory of the sacrifice of our Savior, Jesus. This is a service of remembrance and reflection where we will rehearse some of the events leading up to the crucifixion of Jesus. We will join together in the observance of Holy Communion. The focus of this service is the cross, and specifically the final words spoken by Jesus on the cross. Whenever we speak of the cross, we're not just talking about two rough pieces of wood bolted together. To the follower of Jesus, the cross is much more than that. The cross is a shorthand expression, meaning the death of Jesus. The cross is the place where heaven's love and heaven's justice meet. As we prepare our hearts for this time of meditation and reflection, I want to invite you to stand and to join in singing a hymn of worship. Seated. Before the crucifixion of Jesus, there were several significant events leading up to that momentous time. One of those occurred just outside Jerusalem in the town of Bethany. One evening, Simon the leper invited Jesus and his followers to a dinner in his home. While reclining at supper, a woman came in and anointed Jesus with expensive perfume contained in an alabaster jar. Perhaps this was the tipping point for Judas, for immediately after he went to the chief priest and negotiated the price of 30 silver coins for the betrayal of Jesus to them. Some objected to her act, calling it an extravagant waste. But Jesus commended the woman. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She's done a beautiful thing." He promised that her act would always be remembered, even as we do so tonight. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She has anointed me for my burial."
Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of love.
One of the most dramatic parts of the story of Jesus' last days occurred when he rode triumphantly into the city of Jerusalem on the back of a young donkey in fulfillment of the words of the prophet Zechariah on what we know as Palm Sunday. Crowds thronged the street, cloaks were spread on the road, palm branches were cut and waved. The crowd shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." When the religious leaders objected, Jesus responded, "If these should be silent, the rocks and stones will cry out." Jesus entered the city, went to the temple, where he observed money being exchanged for temple shekels, while the money changers were charging exorbitant fees. And he observed the sacrificial animals being sold for outrageous prices. The next day, Jesus returned to the temple, drove out the money changers, released the animals and the birds from their pens and their cages, declaring, "My house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations." Matthew's gospel records that once the temple was cleared, the blind and the lame came to Jesus and he healed them. Well, no telling of the story of Holy Week would be complete without talking about the night Jesus was betrayed. He gathered with his followers in an upper room for the last meal he would share with them. When they wanted to jockey for positions of importance, Jesus, you remember, removed his outer garment, wrapped a towel around his waist, took a basin of water, and washed the feet of each of his disciples, proclaiming both by word and by deed that if you want to be great in the kingdom, you must be the servant of all. It is service that qualifies you for leadership. At the conclusion of that meal, the group sang a hymn, exited the upper room, crossed the Kidron Valley, and entered the Garden of Gethsemane. There, Jesus agonized in prayer to the point that he sweat great drops of blood. In anguish, he cried, "Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done." The issue was resolved. Jesus was completely surrendered to the will of the Father. Just then, Judas arrived with temple guards. He went to Jesus and identified him with a kiss. Jesus was arrested. The disciples fled. The betrayal was complete.
Sinners in their darkest place, and all I know 'Cause if he could love a traitor, a liar and a faker, if he could break the bread and share.
Following his arrest, Jesus was led away to endure 6 different sham trials, 3 by the Jewish leaders and 3 by the Romans. At 6 a.m., Jesus stood trial for the first time before Pilate, who, when he discovered Jesus was from Galilee, sent him to Herod. At 7 a.m., Jesus was returned to Pilate for his second trial, where he was sentenced to death. At 8 a.m., Jesus was scourged and led away to Calvary. At 9 a.m., the third hour, Jesus was crucified.
Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy prayer.
Shall we?
Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed
For 6 hours, between 9 a.m. and 3 p.m., Jesus hung on the cross, dying in agony and shame. While on that cross, he made 7 great statements that speak to the basic needs of humanity. At first word, he cried from the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Think for just a moment of the people gathered around the cross. There were the Roman soldiers, the execution party. There were the teachers who hated him. There were the priests who bought him with silver. There was the crowd who had cried, "Crucify him." In the distance was Pilate in his palace. There were also some women who had been his followers and supporters. All these were in some sense complicit in the crucifixion of Jesus. And in a very real sense, they are only representative of a wider number of those responsible for his crucifixion. Because the message of the Bible is that it was the sin of the world that crucified Jesus. So in reality, we are all guilty. We crucified the Lord. The wonder of this word from the cross is that there is forgiveness. Forgiveness for every person who has ever sinned. Forgiveness for me, forgiveness for you. Years later, the Apostle John would write, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." I want you to take a moment. I just invite you to reflect on this forgiveness that is so freely offered to you. Think about those places where you have failed. And take a moment, would you, and just ask for his forgiveness for your life. The confidence we have is if we ask, it will be freely granted to us. Take a moment and do that, would you? The second word that Jesus uttered from the cross when he spoke to the penitent thief and said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." This second word narrows the focus to one single needy sinner. See, God not only sees the whole world, but he sees it made up of individuals. The petition from the penitent thief is touching on several levels. In his plea, there was recognition of Jesus as the one who would reign as king, because he said, "Lord, when you come into your kingdom." There was remorse for past transgressions. There was repentance for sin. And there was a plea for remembrance. "Don't forget about me, Jesus. Don't cast me aside. Don't ignore me. Don't hold my sins against me. Somehow, if you can find it in your heart, Jesus, have mercy on me. Remember, I was the one who rebuked the reviling thief. Remember, I was the one who took up for you in your dying moments. Remember, I was the one acknowledging my guilt and pleading for mercy. Remember me." That's a powerful prayer. But somehow, I think his request goes beyond just asking for Jesus to keep him in mind and to extend mercy to him. See, this is a prayer that reaches to another place and into another dimension. Remember, this is a broken man. This is a man whose bones have been pulled out of joint. This is a man whose body has been beaten and bloodied and disfigured. His body is an outward picture of the condition of his inward soul. His soul is fragmented. His soul is broken, ravaged by the penalty of sin. His soul is beaten and scarred by the brutality of sin. This man is totally broken apart. And in his dying moments, he cries to Jesus, "Remember me. Jesus, I'm torn apart. Would you remember? Would you put me back together again? In your kingdom, will you have mercy on me and allow me into your presence, not maimed and broken and fragmented, but whole? Lord Jesus, put me back together. Remember me." The response of the Savior is, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." And I say this is the promise we have from the Savior. When you are broken, when you are fragmented, if you call upon him, he will remember you and make you his honored companion.
Really?
sing that with Pastor Larry as our prayer tonight.
Remember me, put me back together, hold me close forever. Remember me, tell me that you love me, that I'll always be where you'll be.
I'd like you to sing it just one more time together, please.
Remember me, put me back together, hold me close forever. Remember me, tell me that you love me, that I'll always be.
Here where Jesus looks and beholds that his mother is at the foot of the cross. And he says, "Woman, behold your son." And then he looks at John, his beloved disciple, and says, "Behold your mother," and entrusts the care of his mother to the beloved disciple, John. Here, Mary represents the women of the world, all too often treated as inferior. And she represents also those getting on in years. But at the cross, there is no age barrier, no gender barrier. All who come to Jesus are part of his household. This word from the cross is the least theological, but practical application of the gospel must never be separated from its message. It is only as theory is translated into practice that relationship with Christ becomes a living reality. And with this word, we see there is love for you in the cross. It's a love which, having been received, is to then be shared with others. Three words are ended, four yet remain. Let's take just a moment once again to reflect in worship as we sing together once again.
The blood of Jesus washes me.
the darkness comes Jesus cries, my God, why have you forsaken me? It was noon, what should have been the brightest part of the day, but darkness shrouded the earth. A darkness that lasted 3 hours was an outward sign of the darkness that now wrapped itself around the soul of Jesus. All the sin of the world was laid upon Jesus. He who knew no sin was made to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Just as a scapegoat of the Old Testament sacrificial system had to be banished into the wilderness, so Jesus had to bear the sin of the world alone, God forsaken. He who was made sin for us was feeling the punishment of the sinner being separated from God. Jesus truly experienced every condition known to humanity. Would you take just a moment and in your own words and your own expressions, give thanks to him for bearing your sin in your place? He was separated from God so you could be reconciled to God. Take a moment to thank him for that. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Hanging on the cross, Jesus then cries out, I thirst. The hours of torture took such an indescribable toll on the body of Jesus. See, crucifixion was not a sudden death. It was a long, drawn-out, lingering death. The wounds from the nails in his hands and feet, along with the lacerated back from the whipping, would be quickly inflamed, resulting in a fever of thirst, and his body would soon be dehydrated. Both that fourth and the fifth word of Jesus from the cross come from the prophetic 22nd Psalm. In these words, Jesus isn't quoting what David sang. Rather, David spoke these words as a prophetic anticipation of this event. The sufferings of our Savior were very real. Although Jesus was divine, he was also uniquely man and felt all the emotions and pain as we feel them. The fifth word from the cross serves to remind us there is suffering in the cross. And then Jesus cries, "It is finished." The sixth word from the cross consists of one single word in the Greek language of the New Testament. Tetelestai. Finished. Accomplished. What did he mean? What was finished? It was the end of an era. It was the end of the Old Testament ritual. The mission of Messiah was finished. The work of redemption was accomplished. The defeat of Satan was complete. Jesus' cry was proclaiming his victory over the evil one. Notice he didn't say, I am finished, but rather, it is finished. It was a cry of victory over sin, death, and hell. The Greek word for finished was used in the business life of the time to indicate that a debt had been paid. It's like the words stamped across a bill when payment is received, paid in full. This is what Jesus was proclaiming from the cross. Man's account with God has been settled. The debt is wiped out. It is paid. It is finished. And finally, Jesus says, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Earlier, Jesus had said no one could take his life, but he would lay it down of his own accord. He said, I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. See, the life of Jesus didn't just ebb away. Jesus consciously gave his life. These last words of Jesus correspond to the prayer the Jewish mothers taught their children to pray before going to sleep. It's an expression of total trust in God. It's actually a quotation from Psalm 31:5. This particular psalm was composed by David when, in some great trouble, he put his trust in his God. Even though he had been deserted by his friends and treated with utter contempt by his enemies, David continued to trust in God. And this was the response of Jesus. Jesus found security in his Father's hands, and in so doing, pointed the way to all who die believing. This is the place to which the Lord is always trying to bring us, to the place of trust in him. Confident that he will keep us safe and secure in his care. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. It is this trust and confidence we express as we come to the Lord's table. Here, we remember his suffering. Here, we also remember our confidence. It is to this point that this service comes now as we invite you, if you would stand and come to the Lord's table to join me as we share in the communion of the Lord's Supper.
Resurrection. Why should
everyone been served? Did we miss anyone in serving? In his letter to the Corinthian church, the Apostle Paul tells us that in the last meal Jesus shared with his followers before his arrest and crucifixion, he infused the bread and wine with new meaning. The bread now speaks to us of the body of the Lord Jesus that was broken so that we might be made whole. The juice in this cup speaks of the blood of our Savior that was shed to pay the penalty for our sin. And as we partake of these elements, we remember our need for a Savior. We remember the sufficiency of His sacrifice. In this communion, we also remember that we are part of the church universal, part of the family of God, brothers and sisters who share a like faith. As we receive this communion, we receive His divine life into our place of brokenness. And with this communion, we anticipate the soon return of our Lord. This is a table where all who are followers of Jesus are invited to dine. So, Lord, we bless these elements and pray that they may indeed be to us life, health, strength, security, protection, wholeness for every area where we are broken. By faith and with thanksgiving for the price you have paid,
yes.
We now do receive, we take and we eat and we drink. Would you take just a moment and thank the Lord out of your heart. Thank Him for His sacrifice. And thank Him that you are privileged to be part of His forever family through faith in Jesus. Thanksgiving, would you sing it together again? Oh, how He loves you.
Oh, how He loves you and me. He gave His life. What more could He give?
I'd like to ask you to sing that one more time without any of the instrumentation, just our voices lifted together. Would you sing?
Oh, how He loves you and me. Oh, how He loves you and me. Why?
crucifixion of Jesus is complete. Pilate has washed his hands. The disciples have fled. The religious leaders have finished their rituals. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, two secret followers of Jesus, petitioned Pilate for the body of Jesus. They took him down from the cross. They gently washed his broken, mangled body. They carefully wrapped it in a clean linen shroud, placing the pungent burial spices in its fold. They carried him to a nearby tomb in a garden setting, a tomb belonging to Joseph, a tomb that had never been used, a tomb that had been prepared for the future burial of Joseph and his family. A large, heavy stone was rolled in place to close the entrance, and a seal was placed upon it. A guard was posted. The sun has set. The day is over. All is quiet. All is dark. Jesus is dead.